born in the small German village of Hellenthal. She is the only lesbian Holocaust survivor who bore testimony, which she did in an interview with the Holocaust historian Dr. Anna Hukova. In 1937, Margot's family moved to nearby Bielefeld, where she grew up with her younger sister, Lori. Both girls received a secular and a religious education. Their family kept a kosher home, and they celebrated Jewish holidays together. She cherished memories of skiing, biking, and spending time with her cousins and grandfather. Margot's father owned a dry goods store, and her mother was a homemaker. Margot's father also worked for the Jewish organization Hilfsverein für Deutsche Juden, which was a German Jewish organization dedicated to improving the lives and political conditions of Jews in Germany, and eventually became part of the Reich Association of German Jews, the Jewish Council of Germany. Because of his work with this organization, the Heumanns were amongst the last Jewish families to be deported from their town. On June 29, 1943, Margot and her family were deported to the Theresienstadt ghetto. Like almost all children, Margot and Lori lived in a youth home in Theresienstadt. Margot quickly acclimated to the social environment of the camp. Similar to the recollections of many children who survived Theresienstadt, Margot recalls enjoying the ghetto. The youth care was heavily influenced by Zionism, and so Margot too became a Zionist. She also heard her first opera, La Bohème, while in the ghetto. Margot saw her parents daily. Her youth home was also where she met a Viennese girl, Edith Dida Neumann. The two became inseparable and affectionate early on in their relationship. At night, they shared a bed. The two quickly fell in love. In May of 1944, Margot and her family were sent by cattle car to the Theresienstadt family camp of Auschwitz-Birkenau. Margot remembered feeling terrible and very lost at the prospect of leaving Dida. But amidst the hunger and the horror of the new camp, Margot was reunited with her beloved, Dida, who arrived a month later. Shortly afterwards, the two girls were transferred to yet another camp. As Margot was leaving, she recalls her father blessing her with a Jewish prayer.
And my father was standing in front of his barrack, and I went over to him, and he blessed me. And that's the first time I ever saw my father cry. And the last thing he said, that we should stick together, Dita and I. That's the last I never saw him again.
What did he look like?
At the next camp, Dusauer Ufer, Margot waited in line for processing, uncertain whether real showers awaited her. After showering, she looked back and saw Dita still waiting in line. We knew by then that it was okay, Margot recalled. So I lifted my dress up and I showed her, I have a dress, but no underwear. Dida and Margot faced homophobia from fellow prisoners, and Margot recalls her experience of the camps as a harrowing one. We didn't have enough clothing, we were hungry, but we were alive, and I was with Dida.
That made life different, yeah. We used to pretend that we were in different places. What we'll do when we get out? Fantasize about things and share things and care for each other.
Margot and Dida were transported to three different satellite camps of the Neuen Gamm and ultimately ended up at Bergen-Belsen. After they were freed by the British Army in April of 1945, Margot was taken to Sweden to recover from typhus. In 1947, she traveled to the United States to visit relatives. Dazzled by the vibrant lesbian life of New York City, Margot decided to build her new life there in New York. She also changed her surname from Heumann, with two N's, to Heumann, with one N. Margot felt she owed it to her parents to have children. So she married a man and started a family. At the same time, she was maintaining an affair with the wife of a neighbor. "I'm a very good actress," Margot stated regarding her ability to hide her queerness for so much of her life. At the age of 88, Margot formally came out to her family. "I always knew," her daughter, Jill Mendelson, said of her mother's sexuality. Yet, despite Margot's openness about her sexuality, her queer identity is absent from so much of the archival materials that are available about her. It is thanks to the work of Dr. Anna Hakova that Margot's testimony has been preserved without censorship. Margot lived as an openly queer woman until her passing in May of 2022, at the age of 94. She and Dita remained extremely close.
This is a photo taken in Toronto in 1978 while I was visiting with Dita. And Dita is sitting below and I'm above her.
We went to each other's children's bar mitzvahs, children's births, weddings. I was her matron of honor. She credits her relationship and their mutual love for one another as the reason for their survival. Because of my caring for another human being, we remained people.
Neither one of us would have survived without the other, and we both realize that. Because we gave each other hope and support and love and friendship. And I think that's what makes life worth living. And this is why my experiences are probably not very similar to other people's. Because even so, it was absolute hell. What I remember most is my friendship and love for Dita.